Dagan, what's up, dude?
Hey, man, how's tricks? How's things?
Good, man. Can you see me? Do I look okay?
I can see you. You look great. The guitar looks great.
I didn't take a shower.
Very nice. I see you've got some denim on the go as well. It's a definite
denim, I try and do my best to look like an absolute ridiculous lumberjack meets trying to be a rocker guy. You know what I mean? This is all I can do.
Well, he's succeeding, definitely, without a shadow of a doubt.
Oh, dude, I like that amp behind you, brother.
What's I know, up? Yeah. I want to talk about this lovely thing in a bit. I've had this in literally my spare room for the past 3 days, dying to take pictures and show people about it, because I recorded a video as well, man. And boy, yes. It's good.
Thank you so much for doing that, man. That's awesome.
It's great, man. It's great. So I want to talk to you about that in a second. But first, I've been starting these little Zoom interviews.
Oh, yeah.
Asking you how you've been doing, how has lockdown been treating you? Have you been using this time to write and record? Have you been live streaming? What's Jared been up to?
Well, this is the funniest and kind of weirdest time of my life as a musician, to be honest with you, dude. We were hanging out in the UK right before lockdown happened and everything.
We
were actually on tour. We were in Switzerland when they announced a travel ban from the Europe flights to the States. We got woken up, long story short, 3 a.m., basically saying, hey, we're going to drive back to England tomorrow. Tour's over. You guys are getting on a plane and going home.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was crazy, man. It was like, it didn't feel like it was real. So we ended up getting home safe and sound, thankfully. And it took me a while to wrap my head around what was happening. You know, it was like, because I'm so used to being home for a week, 2 weeks. Longest I've been home was over Christmas break. I was home for about 3 weeks. And I was like getting ready, like, when is the next run? When is the next two? When's my next show? And it wasn't happening. So I've been super proactive, man. I haven't been able to have this amount of time, honestly, to just stop and not only like smell the roses of like life and be like in the moment, but it's been great because I've kind of taken a step back and dived in deeper into obviously like practicing, playing guitar, more tone stuff, like having time to like really soak different things in and try different stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And then, yeah, I mean, I signed my first like real record deal this last week with a brand new label here based in Nashville. They have like offices all over the place. They're called Black Hill Records. It's me, a band, friends of mine, Black Pistol Fire, and then The Cult. That was the big label announcement.
Sorry, The Cult. Is that the final one?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So it's really cool. So if now is not a better time, man, now I'm able to really, you know, focus on writing new tunes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm focusing on that like crazy. But the other funny part is all this live stream stuff. Dealing with technology, man. I mean, for me, it's like, I've never done this much stuff. I'm doing a thing with Gibson. It's the Blues Power Hour on Gibson Epiphone channels. But dude, I have the worst luck doing live streams. You know, like I'll lose internet, I'll lose Wi-Fi. So every time it's like I feel like I'm gambling. Like it's like, okay, here we go. Let's connect. But it's been good, man. I've been able to spend time with Amanda, my fiance, and just be home, which is a really a nice change of pace.
Yeah, man. Very cool. Well, it's glad to hear you writing. I want to talk about that record deal in a second because it is absolutely badass. You're a nice mix of modern guitar player and old school blues guitar player. So it's nice to announce something like a valve amp solely through social media and live streams. It's a nice mix of the two, isn't it? It's quite cool.
Yeah, it's really cool. It's kind of weird. You know, we've been talking about the deal and all this stuff. And when is it going to be launched? When are we going to be talking about it? And with the situation, it was all through online, which is, you know, funny, but also with the release of the amp, everything we've done has been like an online thing, which is kind of, you know, on one way you think about it, you're like, well, yeah, that's how everything kind of is now, you know?
Yeah.
But it's weird to not even be out. Like last year when we did the original JJ and 20, I was on the road for 308 days straight, man, touring.
Wow.
The band, and then I went on this crazy like clinic tour with Black Star, which had me going from all over America, and then I zipped over, started in the UK, went all the way to Turkey and Dubai. I mean, I was out for like a month and a half on that. So it's strange. It's really weird, but you know, I'm cool with it. I'm just rolling with it, and you know, it's all good.
Nice, man. Very cool. Well, the one best thing we've got out of this is, of course, your new amp, the JJN20 combo. Something very, very cool, because the Head and Cab had huge success. Like, it was great. I bought one. Loads of folk bought one. They're really cool amps. What made you go to the combo from the Head as opposed to, say, like a 100-watt mega stack?
Well, I think, like, the rocker in me, and, like, the we all love big amps. We love the stacks, the look, the, you know, I even got my fill on the last tour. I started using 412 cabinets and stuff. Yeah. It was amazing. But the reality was, man, is when they did the first JJN20, and I have to thank Blackstar for even trusting me enough to give me that amp, because it's like, you know, no one knew if it was going to totally work or what was going to happen. But the fact is, it worked and people really responded to it. I remember the first talks about it. They were like, oh yeah, we think we're going to make, like, I want to say 35 of them. And I was like, damn, that's, wow. Yeah. And then, you know, the rush hit, and then it was like, they were making 10 times that amount, you know, whatever. But what I noticed, where a lot of people were saying, was like, yeah, it's a cool amp, but man, if I could have a combo version where you could just pick it up and go, you know, you know, if you're going on the tube, or if, you know, you just want to throw it in the back of the car, it's just a lot more convenient. And I'm blown away, man. And I know I have to be the cheerleader for this amp, but really, this thing sounds so good. Mm-hmm. I'm really just blown away. I love the 212 version, of course. That's my baby. But, like, when they sent me this, I looked at it and I was like, all right, what's going on here? And when I plugged into it, I was like, okay, damn. Yeah, I'm sold on this. This is good shit, you know?
Very nice, man. Well, it's a super versatile little amp, and you've obviously got Old Red there. You plugged in. Would you mind giving us a couple of little sound samples?
Absolutely, of course. So where I have it plugged in right now is, I'm on the clean channel. Let me see. And I'm going to hope everyone can kind of hear this. Here's the clean channel. Can you hear that okay?
It's breaking up a little bit. If you could maybe turn the volume down just a smidge so it's not clipping, that'd be great.
Of course, I'm always too loud. Here we go. Does that sound a little better?
It sounds good, man. That sounds great.
Okay, cool. Yeah, the cool part about it is all the tones. Obviously, I'm a big proponent of the volume and tone knob.
Yeah.
So I'm really relying on that to go from the cleans, mm-hmm. really, really clean. Just really, I find myself, you know, like, not even really looking for more gain on this channel, which it's a cool thing, because sometimes I feel like when I plug into an amp, I'll rush through it. I'll rush through the cleans. It's like, okay, you know, but, like, you're really wanting to get what's the drive sound like. Yeah. But with this amp, man, it's really good. A little reverb. I don't know if you can really hear the difference on this.
Oh yeah.
So it's got that built-in reverb, which I love. I definitely am a fan of that. And then moving on to that Blues Power channel. This is where, you know, I play the whole gig, man, is on this channel. Let me see. I'm gonna get it going here. I'm gonna make sure I don't blow you up volume-wise. All the controls set at noon. The distortion, the overdrive control is at 3. Here we go. Let's hear what it sounds like.
That's absolutely badass, man. It is clipping. We might turn it down just a smidge, just a tiny smidge.
Absolutely.
I mean, it sounds badass, but it'll really come through clear.
Let's see. Let's try this.
There we go. Yeah. Okay. Hmm.
Dude.
Oh yeah, it sounds amazing. And people are wondering, it is just the same like layout and valves and everything as the head, isn't it? Just in a combo.
Exact same layout, man. Exact same. And I can pick it up and move it around here when we're done doing the jamming. But it's the same layout, which is really cool because you have the two channels and each channel has two voices. So if I go back, maybe now you can hear this a little better. Here's that first voicing of channel one.
Yeah, that sounds great.
And then the second voicing is more kind of going to that, I would call it that British land that I say it's like the Kossoff. You start to get that nice. It's I feel like it's just right on that tip to go to that crunchy blues sound.
Oh, yeah.
Then moving on that blues power channel, which we just. A little reminder. And if you're crazy like me and you want even more, there's the second voicing of that blues power channel, which here it is. It's nice and nice. And I don't even need that much kids. It's like more than I'll ever use.
That's absolutely badass, mate. It sounds incredible.
Thank you, brother. Yeah. I think what's cool about this, and a lot of guys will be like, oh, what is this guy talking about? But for me to have an amp that has all the tones that I love for blues, rock, and get that chicken picking country stuff, and to hear other people play it, there's just such a dynamic range of tones that I think anyone that plays the stuff that, you know, especially what we love, they're gonna be able to find their own sound in it. And it might be like my signature amp, which to me is still mind blowing, but it's just a great.
It's badass. I mean, it's based off the HD20 platform, which is a super versatile amp anyways. And now it's got your branding on it and it's suitable for everyone.
Yeah, man. And you know, it's other things that are cool about it. Like I'm not a huge pedal guy, but it's got an effects loop. You know, Blackstar was really privy to be like, yo, Jared, although you like this stuff, that's awesome. He's like, someone's going to love this amp and they might need an effects loop. And it got me thinking and I was like, well, I might as well just roll with it and have this thing be the most dynamic amp it can be. So there's like the effects loop. You obviously there's more speaker outputs, USB. It's all around great, man.
But you've always been a player for the people. So this is kind of an amp for the people as well, I guess.
An amp for the people,
which you can carry upstairs in a venue and not have to break your back.
And I mean, I'm going to be honest, man, with the JJAN, the 212 version, it was great. I had that head in a Pelican case and I toured all around the world with that thing in a Pelican case. I would put that on, I remember putting that on like two 4x12s. We were doing festivals and playing huge places. And a lot of people will ask, they'll say, oh, is 20 watts enough? And it absolutely is. Nowadays, it absolutely is, man.
Oh, yeah. 20 watts is allowed 20 watts. And actually, that's quite a fun little thing you mentioned that. What I love about Blackstar's and even your amp, it has got the little attenuator power soak button, hasn't it? So you can blow the crowd's head off, but still practice at a decent volume in your bedroom.
Yeah, which is, it's kind of the best of both worlds because, I mean, I always play loud anyways just because I'm crazy. But like to have that 2-watt setting, it saves your ears and if you're in an apartment or if you're in, you know, you're in one bedroom, the whole house doesn't need to hear you playing, which is great. And just a lot more practical, man. I remember the first time I got a 50-watt tube amp. I won't name any names. I was young and I got a 50-watt and I was like, oh man, this thing's going to sound just like Jimmy Page or Angus Young. You know, I didn't know.
Yeah.
But when I plugged it in and I turned it up to a volume that was okay to my ears, it was like just this really clean. I was like, where's the distortion? Where's the tone?
Yeah.
And said, well, you got to turn those up. You got to turn this one all the way up. So I turn it up, and the first thing I do is basically blow out my eardrums, and I'm just sitting like, to have something that, you know, you can, is practical at home and is practical for a stage. Man, I saw Jeff Beck play a 5-watt Fender on a stool to like 15,000 people and get the most otherworldly tones out of the thing. You know, I used to judge combos by their size, you know?
Yeah.
And that, I really don't, because it's like, you know, they're small in size, but there's a whole 3D dimensional thing that comes from a combo. It's cool. It's awesome.
Totally, man. Well, you've been with Blackstar Valley 10 years though, so I don't think it's any more deserving having your second signature amp with the company.
Well, thank you, brother. Yeah, no, I'm honored to do it. And I love those guys. They've been so good to me, and it's killer, man. It's a great match.
Very nice, man. So it's quite cool. You've got a new amp. You've got a new record deal. Will you be combining the two? And when can we expect a new Jarrah James Nichols album?
Yes, I need to put out a new record. So we're starting right now phase one of the record, which is getting all the songs together, getting all the ideas compiled, demoing everything. It's great, man. This is the first time I've really felt like it's been a right time. I've had like a clear head to make a record, because I have two records out, if anyone wants to check them out. They're called Black Magic and Old Glory and the Wild Revival. And with those records, we basically made those, like every band, you make records to get out on the road to tour, to support them. It's basically now it's like, hey, here's our CD, or, you know, go check us out streaming, whatever. But this is the right time to make a record. So we're going to get in the studio ASAP. I want to have a new record rolled out for whenever we can get back on the road. And it's ready, you know. It's a situation that no musician wants to be put in, but the fact is, you can take it and I'm going to spin it, and I'm going to try and make and craft the best songs in the best package I can.
Hell so yeah.
Soon, man. I mean, I'd get in a studio today if they'd let me, but you know.
We'll be hearing Nails in the Coffin and Thrown to the Wolves on that album, or were they singles in themselves?
You know, we'll see about that.
Pull information from you. I'm just trying to.
No. I mean, that's the thing. You know, like, maybe we could do something else with those. But honestly, I haven't stopped writing. I have so in my phone, in the voice memos, I have like over 150 riffs. Because like, I'd be sitting somewhere, whether it's honestly, I'd be in bed playing guitar at 2 a.m. and all of a sudden I get a riff and I'm like, ooh, this is a cool riff. So I just voice memo backstage, and you can hear people talking and beers clanging, and I'll be playing a riff. So I have all these riffs stockpiled, man. And it's like, I gotta really put those together to make something out of them. Okay. But you know, I was super happy with Threw Me to the Wolves and Nails. And I thought that those came out really great. So we'll see what happens.
Nice, man. I mean, that kind of ties in nicely into, I've got a couple of fan questions as well when it comes to songwriting. Okay. How does songwriting work for yourself? Is it very much sit around a campfire and make things happen? Do you wake up at 3 a.m. and sing it into your phone, like you've already said? Or do you lock yourself in a studio, say, and force yourself to flick the creative switch almost?
Well, for me, I'm such a, yet again, I don't claim to be some monumental musician that needs all this time and this craft work and all these things. I find that I thrive and I survive the best in basically a live environment, or when I'm doing things kind of off the cuff, right? So I was able to work on the first record, Old Glory and the Wild Revival, with Eddie Kramer, who anyone who's watching this will probably have heard that name from either Kiss or Hendrix or Zeppelin or whatever. I got to record at Abbey Road. Yes, that Abbey Road with Eddie Kramer. And I was like thrown in this situation where it was like, I was terrified, man. And you know, one of the first things Eddie said, he's like, oh, just relax. And he's like, you're singing too, yeah? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, all right, well, I'm Robert Plant, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh great. Lord. You know, what do I have to offer, you know? So for me, when we got in that studio, I learned more in like those 2 weeks than I'd learned ever recording. Mm-hmm. He listened to me play and he sat there and he closed his eyes and he listened and he goes, Jared, he's like, you're a guitar player. And I was like, oh, is that a bad thing? And he goes, for you, he goes, it's all about the riff, man. It's all about the riff. He goes, your songs have to mean something. He goes, he said, look at it this way. Your riff, that's the car, right?
Yeah.
Your melody is the tires. Your lyrics are the paint. And I was like, yeah, I kind of get it. He was like, just use the emotion of the guitar to fuel the songs. And it really makes sense. And it's very simple. I've never been able to sit down with like a pad and paper and be like, I love you, baby. This is how I do. And go, you know, yeah. That's not going to happen. Like for me, I have to sit with a riff and I have to hear something and be able to, you know, the first song I wrote with Eddie was Crazy. It was called Crazy. And the riff is so simple. It goes. It's a very simple, simple riff. Mm-hmm. And he said, it's all about the swing. It's all about the groove. Think of how this riff works together and then basically find a melody, find the lyrics, intertwine it. So I'm very off the cuff. The best guitar playing I play, I feel like, is when I'm able to turn my head off and just play and just let it come out. So anything that I've ever written has been, like I said, they're like, I call them like napkin or sound check riffs. It's like you get a riff going, you're like, ooh, this is cool. You know, and not to take away from the music at all, but I just feel like blues and blues rock and basically this kind of music that I grew up loving, a lot of it was made like that kind of, you know, off the cuff, very just straight to the gut.
Yeah.
So that's the way I like to play. And especially like, you know, like a lot of people get down on blues or blues rock guitar players because they're like, oh, these guys only play minor pentatonic. And it's like, yeah, but there's a lot more than that. It's like, that's just the basics. It's like the songwriting, you know, you have to start somewhere. And for me, it all comes down to the riff.
Very nice, man. That's amazing. I wasn't expecting that answer. That's cracking. Yeah.
Awesome. Talk, talk, talk.
This guy won't stop talking. I'm sat here like this. Then just stop talking. Yeah. Oh yeah, I'm actually talking to this guy, aren't I? Yeah, sorry. Right, so songwriting, amazing, very old school approach. That's also your kind of guitar playing ethos. You've always been at Les Paul, cable, amp. And I've been chatting a lot of gear with people. So would you mind telling these guys about, well, we've already covered your lovely Black Star, some Les Pauls and some tasty pedals that you have, if that's okay, Jared.
Yeah, sure, man. Here, let me start out here because this is where it all kind of began for me as a guitar player. This guitar right here, this is called, I'm gonna try and get the glare off a little bit. Hold on one sec. Let me see if this will help me. This is called Old Glory. So this is my signature Epiphone Les Paul Custom Old Glory. As you guys can see, if you haven't seen this guitar before, single pickup, single P90 with a wrap tail bridge, simple volume and tone. Obviously, it's black everywhere. We have the Stinger headstock with the Groverton. This is the model that kind of spurred it all. This is based off an original Gibson that I had. The original one was a 68 Les Paul Custom. Thrashed, battered, horrible. It was just a trash. And I was playing, obviously I play with my fingers. I write left-handed, so the pick just never worked for me. And I found in the beginning that the neck pickup and the toggle switch always got in my way. It was like, I would sit there and be like, dude, if this wasn't here, I would have so much more, you know? It's like in Step Brothers when they're like, oh, we can put our beds together. We'll have more room for activities, right? So that was me with this guitar. So I just ripped the stuff out. It was like, I wasn't using it. So I became the guy, hey man, you're the single pickup guy. And it was funny because I thought I was just doing it for me. And then people were really starting to get into it. I thought it was amazing. So we got a P90. I'm a P90 guy too, which is kind of funny because they're buzzy. You know, a lot of people haven't really messed around with them, but one of my biggest heroes is a guitar player named Leslie West from the band Mountain. He got me into P90s because I feel like it's that perfect middle ground between like a Strat single coil, because it is a single coil, right? And that beefiness you get out of a Les Paul. So I'm going to just plug this thing in real quick. So what ends up happening is with that single coil, I feel like I get the best of both worlds. So I can have like more of a stratty chicken pick. Or if I really want to step on it and get a little, you can get a little bit more. It's very thin. Nice. So, yeah. So for me, that was really the thing. I just love Les Pauls. I was actually, fun fact, I was born in Waukesha, Wisconsin, where Les Paul's from. My grandpa, who I never met, was actually running buddies with Les Paul. They played music together.
That is badass. That is very cool.
Guitar before I knew what it did. You know what I mean? I knew the shape. And I've always been attracted to him. I flirted with everything, man. SGs and Flying Vs and all that stuff. But when it all came back to it, it was the Les Paul. So this guitar, you know, this is the one that kicked it off. And I'm so honored that they wanted to pick someone like me to do a signature model with. And we have a lot of exciting stuff coming up too with Gibson and Epiphone. It's just a beautiful relationship, and I love it dearly. This one right here is the prototype they sent me in November of 2018, dude. I did 308 days straight on the road with this.
You can tell by the bridge.
Yeah, dude. But the funniest part about this guitar is I sit here and I go like this on it. I'll do like a, you know?
Yeah.
I've had done that thousands of times, and it's still, this is an Epiphone. This is not a special Gibson custom shop or anything. This is an Epiphone that they sent over, and the first one, and it's rock solid. So anyone that's thinking about, you know, checking out Epiphones or, you know, really getting into buying a great quality guitar for a good price, I would totally recommend it, man, because I beat the crap out of this thing. Still holds up.
Very cool, man. I mean, for the guys and gals that don't know watching this, this is Jared's signature Epiphone. It's totally available at pmtonline.co.uk. We're going to put a blog out today or tomorrow chatting about Jared's gear and why he uses it. So check the links out for Jared's Epiphone. Badass.
Yes. And now I'll move on to another really cool guitar. This one right here is something, speaking of Leslie West, this is a 1956 Les Paul Jr., all original.
Wow.
This one is yet to travel with me over to the UK, so you haven't played this one yet. But I'm not joking when I say, and everyone says this about their guitars or whatever, this is the best vintage Les Paul Jr. I've ever played. And the reason I say that, man, is every time I see one, I pick it up, if I'm able to. 1956, I heard from many collectors and guys that it was the best year for single cuts. This guitar was gifted to me by a friend of mine, Charlie Daughtry, of the Les Paul Forum.
Yeah.
At same with Old Red. And I just couldn't believe it because I met Charlie at the NAMM show when I released Old Glory. And you can see this one has some scars, man.
Yeah.
She's been dropped. It's been beat up. This is a rock and roll machine, but all original. But when I got this guitar, I was at Charlie's house. We were on tour. I was on tour with John 5. And he said, "Hey, man, why don't you come out and check out the collection?" I was like, "Yes, please." So we were sharing a bus with John. He came and picked me up in the morning at the club. We ended up going back to his place. And I walk in a room, and you guys can imagine what that was like. Filled with Les Pauls. The craziest stuff you'd ever seen. And I was just blown. So I'm sitting there playing, "Hey, you want to try this 59? You want to try this?" Kid in a candy store. And the last guitar he pulled out was this. And he goes, "You love Leslie West. You love Les Paul Jr., stuff like that." And I was like, "Yeah, of course." And I plugged this one in. Now, I don't know. I'm sorry if it doesn't sound good and on your end. But when I plugged this one in, I just smiled, and he walked in the other room, and I see him bring in a case, and he brings in this case, and it's empty, and he goes, "Here, take it." And I was
"Oh, wow."
I was like, "I can't take this guitar, man." I was like, I don't know, most people that are watching this, obviously I can't see the comments or anything, but vintage guitars to me were always something I would play for a few minutes at a music shop. Someone would have one and then they'd go away, you know. I remember the first night this thing was on the bus, it's sitting there in the chair and I'm just staring at it. And I'm just like, "What are you?" You know, and then I played it that night at the show.
Yeah.
And it was laughable how good it sounded. It sounded like all of my favorite records and my favorite tones. So, like I said, super honored to be able to play this guitar. And it's a killer, man. It's a killer guitar.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, I love it. I love old Juniors, and it's really gotten me the affinity for the old stuff.
I was going to say, if you say it's the best vintage single cut you've played, you've played a lot of vintage single cuts, so it must be bloody good.
And, you know, I think a lot of times, too, with a lot of vintage gear, what I've come to find is it's very hard to find really good stuff in the wild anymore. Especially, like, if we're on tour, I would always try and go to different shops or whatever. Most of the time, guys, it's 2020. Things have been picked through. You know, you're not going to find a 6 Junior or an old Standard laying in the corner anymore. You know, most of those have been found. So I'm very lucky to have a friend like Charlie, because he knew it was a good one, and he kept his collection. Because, you know, he had told me, oh, yeah, I've gone through so many guitars, and I kept the real choice ones that play great, you know, and the ones that really sound good. Moving on to this, Old Red.
It's a beautiful thing.
You played guitar a little bit.
I have indeed. And again, I was terrified of touching it, but you absolutely beat the hell out of it, because that's how you get it to sound so good.
Yeah, man. This is, so for everyone watching, this is a 1953 Gibson. Everything about this guitar, besides the frets, this nut, and obviously the overspray, is original. So original P90s, original guard, everything, original switch, all this stuff. The reason, you know, it's an original 53, because I thought that the 53s, when I first got this guitar, had that trap.
Piece thing, yeah.
Yeah. And Charlie ended up telling me, he goes, well, this is a late 53. This is one of the first Les Pauls that would have a rat tail on it, because it's very thin. They call them the Mickey Mouse ears. Now I'm getting super nerdy with you. But the rat tail, the ears on it are so thin.
Yeah.
But anyways, you can see on this that there's gold. I'm not sure if it's going to pick it up.
Yeah, mine is coming through.
It's like a Dakota red that had been sprayed over the gold. So what you're getting is a gold top underneath. And as I'm playing it, it keeps showing up more and more. It's awesome, man.
I love this. The red pop a bit more as well, having the gold underneath.
Yeah, you can kind of see it down here a lot. But yeah, in this guitar, I was scared of it. Like, I was scared. And when I got this from Charlie, I said, dude, I can't take these. This is like torture. You're torturing me. And he goes, man, you're not going to do anything to that guitar that it hasn't already been done to it. You know, this thing rode here. And you can see this is all from me. As far as I just started, now that I've been playing it, I'm really wearing through the finish a lot. But the tuners are original. I remember I was on the road and I called Charlie and I said, hey, man, do I need to change out these tuners? And he goes, why? And I said, well, don't they say the original tuners are going to break off? He goes, man, those tuners have been on there for 67 years. I don't think they're going anywhere. You know, so it's just really cool. And this is, for me, one of the first guitars that I started doing the neck pickup thing with. But the reason I started that, man, was because the simple reason that this neck pickup sounds like Clapton. And when I heard it and I started to play it, I just started laughing. So check this out. It's got that
that was incredible, mate.
And when you roll back the tone knob on that neck pickup and try to get that, it's just right there. That
so nice.
You know. And you know the pickups are really well balanced. The bridge pickup is thunder. And there's something about it, man. You play different. These things inspire you differently. It's like you're walking in and picking up a time machine. You know, this is like what our heroes, you know, would have picked up. You know, a lot of guys flavor the bursts, of course, and it's a beautiful thing. But like, to me, I love the P90 so much, and I love the rat tail.
That you want to fight with it a bit more, haven't you?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I sweat on this thing, and I beat the hell out of it in the most loving way possible. And man, it stays in tune like crazy, and it has never given me a problem. So that's it.
Well, hopefully we'll see it soon. I've got a couple more fan questions, then I'll let you get back to your day.
I talk too much, guys. I'm sorry.
Dude, it's good. People love hearing from you. It's great.
Oh, cool. Awesome.
Right. So, dude, obviously your tour was cancelled halfway through. We've been through that. Are there any plans to come back to Europe once this is all over? Because you spent a lot of time in Europe. And obviously that isn't your choice to choose what's happening. Or are you going to wait until the new album's out and then release it on us over here?
Well, I'm honestly hoping that this doesn't take too long for all of these, you know, all musicians to start traveling again. I'll be there as soon as possible. As soon as they open the doors and they say it's okay, we will be back on the road. That's 100%. We'll do it safely as we can, but I mean, I miss it so much, man. And this is the most interaction I get, which is
same.
It's like taking an animal and putting him in a cage. You know what I mean? So I hope that we can go back to the UK and to Europe and tour. Now, if it coincides with the album release, that's great. But if not, I'm sure we'll be back, man. You know, we've built such a loyal following now in the UK and Europe of not only guitar fans, but blues and blues rock fans and rock fans, that we're going to keep coming back no matter what. That's not the issue. It's just when. So I truly will be as soon as possible, man.
Very cool, man. Let's leave it on a high. What is your favorite song to play live and why? Tough one.
You know, for me, I would say an original, but like we always end the set with Mississippi Queen, which it's like my favorite song ever. And I love playing that song. To me, it's the quintessential rock tone, rock song. Everything about it I love. So I would have to say Mississippi Queen is my favorite to play live. If I had to pick one of my own, I'd probably pick the new single, Threw Me to the Wolves, because it's so different. It's got so much dynamics that I'm able to get my finger picking on, and then I'm able to get into the solo and really just let it rip. So I love them all like children, man. These are my little things. So every song, even if it's a dirty, disgusting song, you know, I just try and go all in every song, really commit to it and commit to the music.
Nice one, man. Well, would you mind playing us out with a bit of Mississippi Queen or Three Me to the Wolves? And while Jared's plugging his guitar in, guys, check out Three Me to the Wolves, Nails in the Coffin, Black Magic, Old Glory, and The Wild Revival on Spotify, because they're absolutely badass. And Jared, take it away. Thank you for your time.
I gotta play it on the 56 like Leslie would have.
Hell yeah.
Oh, I gotta show you something real quick. Where's
Go for it.
I got this from a fan. It's a stage used Mississippi Queen cowbell.
Nice.
But I don't have a.
Oh man, <my God. laughs>
Yeah, buddy.
Absolutely badass. Thank you so much, Jared, and stay safe.
Thank you for having me, brother.
Nice one, man. I'm going to be plugging this in as soon as I get off this as well. So thank you for the inspiration, as always.